stood on a hillside, and I saw men and women, boys and girls, holding each other's hands. And as they looked into each other's eyes, no one was afraid. And I said to the angel, "Where is this?" And the angel said, "This is the kingdom of God." And I said to the angel, "Who are these?" And the angel said, "These are they who have come out of great tribulation, who have washed their robes white in the blood of the Lamb." And I said to the angel, "What is this?" And the angel said, "This is heaven."
there is a African tradition regarding those who die in the Lord. They would not think of those who died in the Lord as having departed. They would not speak of those who had a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ and were believers as having departed. Rather, they would look from the vantage point of the glory land. So instead of thinking and speaking of them as having departed, they would say they have arrived. The African tradition, based on Holy Writ, is for those who die in the Lord to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. So during the celebration of that person's life, they would enter into the house of worship with joy and enthusiasm. They would sing and praise God, declaring, "He has arrived. She has arrived." I would that be the sentiment and spirit that govern and guide us this afternoon as we celebrate today Doris Wright Leevy Johnson. I would that we think as the African tradition, she has not departed, but she has arrived. Let's put our hands together, if you don't mind, and praise God for the arrival of one who has but transitioned from earth to heaven to live eternally with Jesus through ceaseless ages. The family has prepared and made available an order of service that will govern our celebration this afternoon. And we will want to follow the order as has been given to us on the ninth. Let's celebrate.
Lord, book of Proverbs, chapter number 31, verse number 10, and verses 28 through 31. There we shall find these words thus written. Who can find a virtuous woman?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
For her price is far above rubies. Her children arise up and call her blessed, her husband also, and he praiseth her. Many daughters have done virtuously, but thou excelleth them all. Favor is deceitful, and beauty is vain. But a woman that feareth the Lord,
yes.
Yes, sir. She shall be praised. Give her of the fruit of her hands,
yes. And
let her own works praise her in the gates.
Yes, sir.
God's word.
Our New Testament scripture comes from the book of Luke, the 10th chapter, verses 25 through 37, the parable of the Good Samaritan. On one occasion, an expert in the law stood up to test Jesus. Teacher, he asked, what must I do to inherit eternal life? What is written in the law? He replied, how do you read it? He answered, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. You have answered correctly. And Jesus replied, do this and you will live. But he wanted to justify himself, so he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? In reply, Jesus said, a man was going down Jerusalem to Jericho. When he was attacked by robbers, they stripped him of his clothes, beat him and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road. And when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, a Doris Wright Leevy Johnson, as she traveled, came where the man was. And when she saw him, she took pity on him. She went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then she put the man on her own donkey, brought him to an inn and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper. Look after him, she said, and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expenses you may have. Which of these 3 do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers? The expert in the law replied, the one who had mercy on him. And Jesus said, go and do likewise.
Let us bow our heads in reverence to God. Gracious God, loving Father, wonderful Savior, hearts are broken, spirits wounded, questions abound, eyes are moved with tears as we celebrate the virtuous life of Doris Wright Leevy Johnson. We want to thank you, Heavenly Father, for your glory that was evident in Doris's character of Christ, exhibited among all of us who knew her. We thank you, God, for her life of service and her influence of good from which all of us benefited. As we come to you at this hour of grief, we ask God that you would show forth your presence with love and might and strength. Comfort this family in their bereavement. Hold them in their sorrow and walk with them in their grief. We commend to you just now the Leevy Johnson family and asking you, dear God, to do what only you can do. We embrace the spirit of the psalmist who said, I will lift up mine eyes into the hills from which cometh my help. We thank you for the assurance of your help that is ours, and so let it be, dear God, for the Leevy Johnson family. This family needs a strength beyond who we are as mere mortals. So we ask it of you just now, God, be that strength that only you can be, a strength that comes from who you are as our refuge and our strength. In light of the grave need for strength, we summons just now your strengthening angel to greet them each day that they are awakened in the morning with new mercies, and escort them day by day during the grief process, moment by moment, is what we ask of you in the name of Jesus Christ. Be pleased, dear Lord, to grant afresh all of your anointing on Pastor Chris Leevy Johnson as he ascends this sacred desk to eulogize his mother. And now, Lord, we pray for your sustaining grace to be with us. Keep us in the days ahead and the years have come. Keep us, dear God, until that day when we shall be reunited with Doris and others who have gone on before us to that land where saints immortal reign, pleasures banish pain, infinite day excludes the night. Keep us until that day where Job said, the wicked shall cease from troubling and the weary shall be at rest. Keep us until that day where we can come face to face with Jesus our Christ, the resurrection and the life. That day that we shall worship and praise you through ceaseless ages. 'Tis your servant's prayer. In the victorious name of Jesus our Christ, amen, and thank God.
Standing next to him was his best man, his grandfather, I.S. Leevy. He looked down the aisle of First Adventist Baptist Church and saw my mother walking towards him, escorted by my grandfather, George Wright. As she got closer, he noticed that she was crying. Tears of joy or tears of terror? He didn't know. So as soon as she got close, being a young trial lawyer, he cross-examined her. Doris, why are you crying? She replied, I.S., I forgot your wedding ring. That was the only mistake she made in 54 and a half years of marriage. She was the perfect wife. Well, let me rephrase that. She became the perfect wife. See, when they got married, she didn't know how to cook. But as she often told me, George, if you can read a recipe, you can cook. So she collected recipes and eventually got to the point where she wrote her own recipes. She became such a good cook that she and her recipes were featured in the living section of the state newspaper. I spent the past couple days thinking about my mother, her cooking, and her recipes. I wondered what recipe God used when he made my mother, because it was perfect. At first, I thought the recipe had three ingredients: beauty, brains, and brawn. Beauty, brains, and brawn. Beauty because she was beautiful inside and out. She was homecoming queen at Sage Johnson and Miss West Virginia State University. Brains because she excelled academically at C.A. Johnson, West Virginia State, and the Ohio State University. Brawn, because you have to be a strong woman to put up with Doris Wright Leevy Johnson for 54 and a half years. But the more I thought about it, the more I was convinced that it was a one-ingredient recipe. That ingredient was love. She was filled with love, she was generous with her love, and she showed us she loved us every day. She showed her love by endowing a scholarship at her beloved Benedict College. Amen. When she saw potential in a young man from Pringletown, South Carolina, she took him in, loved him, mentored him, helped pay for college. She was so proud when he became the Reverend D.D. Rivers. She showed Chris how much she loved him by proofreading his papers. From middle school through his doctoral dissertation. Chris's PhD should say Chris and Doris Johnson. She also showed Chris how much she loved him by getting him his job back every time he got fired at Leevy's funeral home. And he got fired a lot. She showed me her love by encouraging me to follow my heart when I was considering doing a modern-day Romeo and Juliet by marrying the daughter of our competitor, Anthony Manigault Hurley. If love can be measured in dresses and shoes and purses, then she really loved her two daughters-in-law, Michelle and Cynthia. If you've spoken to my mother in the last 18 years, then you talked about her grandbabies. You could see by how she spoiled them and bragged about them that she really loved them. But the greatest recipient of her love was my father. It was because of her that he was able to reach the heights of the legal profession. Because if he could convince Doris Wright to marry him, anything was possible. As I've said before, she was a beauty queen at C.A. Johnson and West Virginia State. She had a master's degree from Ohio State. When they were dating, she was employed as a teacher. Her students loved her. She had two loving parents who didn't want her to ever leave the house. And back then, if you'd asked her, she would have told you she didn't ever want to get married. That might be why it took my dad three times to convince her to marry him. But she saw something in him, and it was through her eyes that he saw something in himself. Tomorrow is Valentine's Day. For 54 years, my father would give my mother a dozen roses and a card on Valentine's Day. A few days ago, he had to go to a drugstore to pick up a prescription for her. While there, he decided to get a Valentine's Day card. He did not get one card. He got two. He said he wanted her to know in multiple ways how much he loved her. Dad, she knew.
I shall wear a crown. Crown. I shall wear a crown. When it's all over, when it's all over, I shall see His face. I shall see His face.
I'm gonna tell. Thank you. atmosphere. My dad needs it. My dad needs to feel your energy. My dad needs to feel your energy. Let's change this. And I know it's not for everybody. Everybody does it in a different way. But my dad needs to feel your energy. Congressman Clyburn lost his wife because he just for my daddy, because they're going through the same thing that others of you who have lost your wives and lost your husbands and lost your children, and you understand the pain of that first few. And we as undertakers and we as your funeral workers have stood on the outside, and now we're standing on the inside. And so we have not always felt the pain that you felt, because we were helping you get through the pain. So now I need you to help us get through the pain. I just need a few believers who believe that when you die in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, it is not mourning, it is not sadness, and there should be a celebration that you know that mama has made it on home. And I don't care what's going on right now in your spirit and how hard it might be and the pain that you feel, but I'm sorry right now, but my soul rejoices in the fact that my mama is gone on to be with Jesus. She's gone on to be with the Lord. She made sure that her two sons were saved. She made through with that. We had everything. She took care of her husband, and I'm all right now. I said, I'm all right now. I said, I'm all right now. For the strength of the Lord, the strength of the Lord. Hey! Ah, yes! When I'm weak in my infirmity, the strength of the Lord is my power. Where do you start? Where do you start when your subject is the one who started you? Where do you start when your brother has preached your entire eulogy? Where do you start when so many of your clerical colleagues here to support you? And so you got to make sure that you're homiletically correct and your hermeneutics will pass seminary standards. Where do you start when your subject in your mind and your eyes and your heart was indeed perfect, but you don't want to be too braggadocious? Where do you start when your heart is bleeding, but your soul is rejoicing that you know that your mama made it on home? Where do you start when you don't even know where to start? Where do you start where, yes, you know you're going to have to do this. You've been preparing for this for years because you knew that this moment would come, but you woke up this morning saying, I know today is not that day. Where do you start where you have been overwhelmed with 400 text messages and you want to tell people to leave you alone, but their blessing comes for being a blessing to you? Where do you start for the one that you loved you so much that her nickname for you was love? When she called you, she said, how are you doing, love? When she said goodbye, she said, I'll talk to you, love. When you traveled, she called you. And I don't know how she knew I was on the plane to have a safe trip, love. To make sure when you landed, did you land
love. It is not coincidence, it is by God's providence that we gather here on the day before the calendar says we're supposed to love one another. I pray to God that you don't wait till February the 14th to tell someone that you love them. My mother was our everything. As George talked about, she did everything for her three boys. I did not know what a chore was until I got married. My mother was the epitome of love. She waited 15 years before going back to work. She waited until George got his license and was able to take me to school and take him to school before she went back to work. She cooked three hot meals a day and took lunch every day to her husband while being his bookkeeper. She picked up his check on Fridays and paid every bill in the house. She was the epitome of love. And I gather here today and we come in today, and from our perspective, immaturely, or rather, we come earlier than we wanted to come, even though she lived a long, gracious life. We had prayed that she would be like Hezekiah and that God would extend her years a little bit longer. She had a 3-year battle with cancer. But we never thought, we never even imagined that it would take her out the way it took her out. She was so strong that you did not even know that she was battling it. She was so strong that you didn't know that she was aching on the inside. She was so strong that her beauty and her radiance, and even after taking chemotherapy, God would not even allow her hair to fall out. She was love. Dr. Scott is our pastor's, Dr. Scott is our family pastor. My mother grew up in the First Nazareth Baptist Church where she played the piano for the church. His uncle married my parents, and he is our family pastor on both sides. He is the Wright's pastor, which is my mother's maiden name and her family. My grandfather, who George is named after, was a trustee in his church. He is our family's pastor. Reverend Jackson just signs my check. But Dr. Scott, as I began to think about what would I say today, I'm not here to be impressive. I'm not here to talk about Carl Barth and Tillich and James Cone. I'm not here, Dr. Estep, to impress these people with the ontological, the teleological, and the cosmological makeup of God. I'm not here to find some scripture you never heard or thought about or know that I could tie in to a text. I just stopped by to talk about my mama. We told Dee Dee and we told Dr. Scott, pick whatever scripture that the Lord lays on your heart. And it is only by God's providence that when God told me what to talk about, is what he told you what to talk about, Dr. Scott. For King Lemuel raises that query in Proverbs 31 and 10. Who can find a virtuous woman. Who can find a virtuous woman? We have no idea who King Lemuel is. Theologians debate that, whether he is Solomon, whether he is Hezekiah, or whether he is a fictional character to be used just to give the characteristics of a virtuous woman. In the book of Proverbs and in chapter 31, there are 17 characteristics of a virtuous woman. And because my dad told me, take as long as you want to, son, I will only deal with three and not all 17. He raises the query based upon the teachings of his mother. And most of us would believe that King Lemuel actually is Solomon, and that the mother that he is talking about and the one who gave him this wisdom is Bathsheba. He talks about the political aspects of society, but then he becomes very practical because his mother showed him how to find a good wife and what the virtues would be of a good wife. My mother showed us in her living and by her example what a good wife and what a virtuous woman was supposed to be. And that is why it was so very easy for George to marry Michelle. Still ain't figured out what Cynthia was thinking about. For those of you who don't know, Cynthia and I met on a blind date, and she's been blind ever since. But his mother shows him 17 characteristics of what a virtuous woman is all about. But he begins this pericope by raising the query, who can find a virtuous woman? And Dr. Watson, if he raises the question, who can find a virtuous woman, it means that in his day and age, and even in our day and age, it is hard to find. Try this side. If he raises the question, who can find a virtuous woman, it must mean that it must be problematic, Bishop, in finding a virtuous woman. If he has to ask the world, who can find a good woman, obviously, it is a rare find, just as the ruby he talks about, Jamie, in the next chapter, in the next verse, because a virtuous woman with all these characteristics is hard to find. But I want to stop by and tell King Lemuel, we found her. We found her in Waverly Hospital on November 16th of 1939. We found her at the St. Martin de Porres Catholic School, where she was raised for 8 years, and where she would tell me that after 8 years of Catholic school education, that she would forget more of the Bible than I would ever learn. We found her at First Nazareth Baptist Church in Sunday school, and then playing for the church choir. We found her at C.A. Johnson High School, where she was on the newspaper board at newspaper club, and where she was head majorette and homecoming queen. We found her at West Virginia State University, where she pledged Delta Sigma Theta Sorority Incorporated. We found her where she was Miss West Virginia State University, where she didn't need to hear Thomas Whitfield say, I shall wear a crown, because she's already worn a crown.
and she's worn a couple of crowns. We found her at Ohio State University working on her master's in zoology and then returning back to Columbia and doing her student teaching at W.A. Perry Middle School and then doing her teaching at Booker T. Washington High School, where she closed down the school because of integration in 1970. We found her 2 years earlier down at the altar of First Nazareth Baptist Church, where she married this young man who was an undertaker who thought that he knew everything. But the best thing he knew was to marry her. And y'all missed the truth in the joke, but the truth in the joke that it did take him 3 times for her to finally say yes. He asked once for the father, she said, oh no. She asked him once for the son, she said, I'll think about it. And on the 3rd time, she saw his potential at Wells Fargo, and she said, I'll do it. We found her giving birth to 2 boys that she raised to be men. She found her, and we found her adopting 2 daughters who weren't her daughter-in-laws, but were her daughters that she loved dearly. And for all of you women who, you will understand that when she bought her St. John, she bought her daughter-in-law St. John. That's love. We found her working at Benedict College for 31 years. We found her rising to the ranks of Associate Vice President of Institutional Advancement. We found her that the fact that even after she retired, they didn't want to lose her, so they put her on the Board of Trustees. We found her then helping her husband and her son at the funeral home in retirement. And she served our families by calling each one of them after their services to check on them. I tell you, we found her. But then Lemuel goes on again to lift up 17 characteristics of a virtuous woman. And I just want to lift up 3, if you don't mind. The first one comes out of verse 9. And in verse 9, Lemuel says that the heart of her husband doth safely trust in her, so that she shall have no want of spoil. Her husband trusts her so much that she would have no want of spoil. The first characteristics, Senator Jackson, of my mother is that she honored her husband. My mama loved this man more than Sophia loved Harpo. My mother loved I.S. Leevy Johnson in word, deed, and action. My mother loved him so much that she did everything that a wife does or used to do to the point that when my dad says, I don't know how I'm going to make it without you, he means it. Because the only thing my dad had to do was wake up, take a shower, go to work, and come back home. And everything else was taken care of for him. He knows not even how to boil water. It might sound funny to you, but it's not, because my mother did what she was supposed to do as his helpmate. She helped him in every aspect of life. And the text says that her husband trusts her so much that she will have no need or want of spoil. And the definition of spoil in the Bible is material blessings. The definition of spoils in the Bible is material blessings, not being spoiled like she spoiled George and I, but that she would have everything she wanted. You all don't want to hear this term submissive because you think it means weakness. You think it means that you have to bow down and cater to. But submissive only means respect and honor. And my mother respected and honored her husband by making sure that he had every need met. And because, Mom, she made sure he had every need met, my dad, in turn, made sure that she had every need met. And let me break this down for you real plain. Again, Mama came and picked up Daddy's check every Friday. Daddy don't know how much money in the account because of the trust that they had and the love that they had. And because he loved us so much, there was nothing that she could do, buy, or bring home that mattered to him. George tells you that it's difficult being married to him and me. George ain't the problem, it's us two. And Mama used to say that dealing with my dad had his issues and had his problems, but she got medals for her meritorious service. That just like being in the army, when you do good, she would get medals. Her medals came in the form of St. John. They came in the form of Ferragamo. They came in the form of Jimmy Choo. They came in the form of Jacob the Jeweler. She got any and everything she wanted because she was a virtuous woman. And when you submit yourself and honor your spouse that way, your spouse will make sure you will never have a need in all your life. She honored her husband, but as Dee Dee so correctly described in the verse in the chapter of Luke that he talked about, she also helped out humanity. It's here in the text, it's in verse 20. She reaches out to the poor. She stretches her hands out, rather, to the poor, and she reaches out to them that are in need. My mother was not Bill Gates, wasn't a Cosby, but my mother was a philanthropist. My mother started two endowed scholarships, one for her mother and one for my dad's mother at Benedict College. They started scholarships at Claflin University. They single-handedly started the biomedical magnet program at Sid Johnson High School. We talk a lot about Dee Dee, but they sent three young men to college. My mother, as George said, proofread all of my papers since my junior year of high school. And even when I was in college, I would email my papers home for my mom to edit and proofread, and she would send them back. She read all 309 pages of the dissertation she wrote. And George was not joking when he said, I literally went and took my PhD diploma to Kinko's, had them white out my name, and put her name in there. And if you go to our house right now, you will see a PhD to Doris Wright Leevy Johnson from the University of South Carolina. But it went beyond just material things. It was cooking for those who were sick. When her friends and two of her closest friends had breast cancer as well, she made sure that they ate every day. It was baking cakes and baking pies and checking on people. It was not only proofreading and editing my work, but I don't think anything went out of Benedict College without mama reading and proofreading, and other ones of her adopted sons that she would proof their applications and proofread their resumes, and she was always doing etiquette classes, and she was the Heloise before there was the Heloise. And I know that we're in a mixed congregation, and I thank God that we have other people from all races, ethnicities, and creeds, but she was the first black soccer mom. She took care of all of us. She took care of her village. And we had a village, as Wendy Platt talked about, where her dad was our soccer coach, and that you could let your children stay over at other people's houses back then. Y'all remember them days. You can't even let them stay over your uncle's house right nowadays. But there was a day that we used to stay over each other's houses. And Mama was that soccer mom that invited everybody over, and we would have sleepovers, and she would cook, and she would make sure that we had everything. She served humanity. She was always doing something for others, because that she knew that all of us who have been blessed must be a blessing. She honored her husband. She helped out humanity. But third and finally, Dr. Scott, she knew that heaven was her home. She honored her husband. She helped out humanity. But my mother knew that heaven was her home. Lemuel declares in 30 and 31, favor is deceitful, beauty is vain, but the woman who fears the Lord shall be praised, and she shall be praised in the gates. Favor is deceitful. She was favored in life materially, but it can be deceitful. Because just like Job would tell you, you have it one day and it can be gone tomorrow. She was beautiful. She was a queen. Her mama was an arrogant and conceited in her beauty. Her beauty was on the inside more so than it was on the outside. Because all of us will change. All of us will lose our hair. All of us will lose vision. All of us will not be the beauty queen that we were at 20. So she knew not to put all of her joy and all of her countenance in her outside beauty. But what was more important was her inside beauty. But Lemuel here, Charles Jr., is talking to other women. He's talking about the gates to the old Jerusalem. He is saying here in the text that when your wife or when your loved one, whenever your daughter, but especially your wife, walks into the gates, they should respect her. That they should praise her for having the qualities of a virtuous woman. That's why that woman at the well had to go to the well at noonday, because of her life, because she had a shaky life. She had a life that was not of virtue, that was not of piety. And so she was embarrassed to go to the well when the other women were around, because she knew that the other women would talk about her. But Lemuel says, my mama taught me to make sure that I marry a woman, that I date a woman, that I have a woman, that when she enters into the gate, everybody will know that she is a virtuous woman. But I believe that even though Lemuel was talking about some earthly gates, there are some heavenly gates that my mama has already and will enter. That because she was a woman of virtue, that there are some heavenly gates. And when she walks into those heavenly gates, I don't think that, I know I'm anti-scripture and going against the scripture, so you're going to have to forgive me, but my baptized imagination suggests that she might not have to go to the judgment, because I think all the things she's got to do is show Peter a picture of my daddy, and Peter's going to say, you were married to him for 54 years? Come right on in. You done been through enough. Ain't no need for us to take you through no more. You had to raise Chris Leevy Johnson? Matter of fact, take bus one, seat one, you're going right on down to the throne. That you've done enough, and we're going to praise you for all that you did down on earth, because you were and are a virtuous woman. Let me fast forward because my dad's biting his lips and that means that my time is done. Mom had cancer. She battled with it for 3 years. She was diagnosed in November of 2020. And she went into remission 3 months later in February of 2021. It was indeed a miracle. And so when it came back last December, we thought nothing of it, Dr. Scott. She'd already beaten it once. We knew that she was going to beat it again. They put her on the same chemo pill that she had the first time, and the chemo pill didn't work. And so she had to go through real chemo. And I'm sorry, but that real chemo will kill you more than the cancer will kill you. And she began to get weak, and she began to get weary. And Dad and I and George and I were taking care of her, and I began to see, Bloom, that her steps began to be a little shorter. Her pace began to be a little low. She couldn't go up steps like she used to with the same agility. She didn't complain, but she did say that this thing is hard. She was going through chemotherapy, and we were taking her out to South Carolina Oncology, sitting with her as she was going through her 4 hours of transfusions. And I noticed my mom began to change without complaining. And fate would have it that on last weekend, I was honored to be invited to do and officiate a wedding in the Dominican Republic. It's what you call a destination wedding. And let me put a quarter in the meter for anyone who's about to get married, and you're about to get married overseas, just call me, I'll come. I'll pay for my own ticket. If you got sand, I'll lift my hands and pronounce you man and wife. And I'm out of town, Dad, out of the country. And I get this frantic call on Sunday night that Mom has been rushed to the hospital and it doesn't look good and you need to come back ASAP. Well, the wedding was on a Monday evening. I've never heard of a wedding on a Monday. Maybe it's a Dominican thing, but the wedding was on Monday, Charles, and I wasn't about to leave this couple stranded. And so I said, put Mom on the phone. And they FaceTimed my mom from her hospital bed. And I said, Mama, how you doing? And she said, son, I'm in pain. I said, Mama, it's gonna be all right, but Mama, can you do me one thing? I said, can you wait till I get back home on Tuesday? And through FaceTime, she said, I'll wait till you get back home, son. But in the meantime, because I'm a son, I began looking for flights. I began looking for flights because you do want to be there with your family. There might not have been nothing else, Anne, that I could do for my mama, but I needed to be there for my family. But Punta Cana only got 2 flights out every day, and none of them were going to get me home any sooner. But I said, Mama, will you wait for me? And she said, I'll wait for you, baby. I landed Tuesday around 5:30 in Charlotte and got to the hospital around 7 o'clock. And by that time, she was no longer conscious. She was no longer able to speak. Her eyes were almost glued shut. And I held her hand and I said, Mama, it's your baby. Do you know I'm here? If you know I'm here, squeeze my hand. And she squeezed my hand. I said, Dad, go on home. I'll stay here until Mama falls asleep. Yeah. That next morning, I woke up uneasy in my spirit. And Dr. Scott, I called a nurse and I said, how did my mama do through the night? And she says, you and your daddy need to get here quickly. Daddy had already been told that she was going to have to go on hospice. And there are three types of hospice. Hospice where you had a facility, hospice where you had home, and hospice where you stay in the hospital. And Daryl, when I got to the hospital Wednesday morning, they were there with the papers for Dad to sign to agree for her to go in to hospice. And they said that it's so bad that she's going to have to stay here in the hospital under hospice. George arrived to the hospital as they were telling us all the stuff that they needed to tell us medically about her treatment. But I apologize, I didn't need to hear all that, because Mom and I dwell in the supernatural. That was happening in the natural. But there was something else going on in the supernatural. And Daddy was calling somebody to come clean the carpet to get ready for his wife to come home. Daddy was calling the carpenter to come build a ramp because she couldn't no longer go up steps and she was gonna need a walk ramp to get into the house because Daddy was expecting her to come on home. And I'm sorry, Daddy, don't be mad at me, but while you were talking to that carpenter, I was talking to another carpenter. I was talking to another carpenter. I began to talk to that carpenter that came up through 40 and two generations. I began to talk to that carpenter that was born in the back streets of Bethlehem. I began to talk to that carpenter who began to give healing to those who could not hear and sight to those that could not see. And that carpenter that began to heal lepers, that carpenter that took two sardines and five hush puppies and turned it into a seafood buffet on the hills of Carmen. I talked to that carpenter who turned water into wine. And while they were signing papers, I went into my mama's room and began to talk with the carpenter and my mama. And I said, Mama, if you want to fight, keep on fighting, but if you're ready to see Jesus, go ahead, Mama, take your wings. I'm talking to the carpenter right now, and he's building you a mansion right now with your name on it. I wish I had a witness here right now that understands that there were two doctors on the case, the doctors at Providence and the doctor that has all Providence. You missed that. The doctor at Providence on Forest Drive and the doctor that has all Providence. And my carpenter came in the room, and my carpenter told me that this is your final moment with your mama. I left the hospital that moment because I gave my mama to Jesus. I went back to the funeral home and waited because I knew that the angel was coming to get my mama. I don't want you to think I've been insensitive, but I had already made my peace with my mama, but more importantly, I knew that my mama had made her peace with her Lord. So there was nothing else for me to do on this side but to pray for my daddy and pray for my brother. Well, my mama went on to be with the Lord. And I need to let you know I have not yet seen my mama since that time that me, her, and Jesus had a conversation. I have not seen my mama in that casket because I've only seen my mama alive. And I believe because she knows Jesus, I believe because she's gonna see him one day. My last memory with my mama is her alive with me and her talking to her maker. I wish I had a witness here that I'm all right right now. I'm happy right now. I'm rejoicing right now. I know it hurts, Daddy, but no more pain, no more chemo, no more radiation, no more worrying about how we're gonna make it. I know it's tough, Daddy, but the carpenter has come by and seen about your wife. The carpenter has come and taken mama on home, a house that has not built with hands, that's eternal, 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 eternal in the heavens. Who can find? a virtuous woman. We found her.
In a spirit of true celebration, after the uncommon courage we witness from Doris Wright Leevy Johnson's son, we prepare ourselves now for the recessional. Son, God moved mightily. And we would all of you to know that you have some additional pairs of shoulders who are available and willing to help you walk through and carry the load of grief you now bear. Just before Reverend Ron Best and our choir sing by request, he'll welcome me. The final word from this sacred desk is given to us by the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 50 through 58. Hear ye Paul as he says, now this I say, brethren, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Neither doth corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall all be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruption shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, but the strength of sin, glory, hallelujah, is the Lord. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know, your labor is not in vain in the Lord. We have the victory, thanks be unto God, in and through Jesus our Christ. God bless you. Direct.
Just lying,
just to live again.
And with the Lord,
and with the Lord, I know that I shall reign.
I shall